May the righteous be glad and rejoice before God. May they be happy and joyful. Sing to God, sing in praise of his name, extol him who rides on the clouds. Rejoice before him, his name is the Lord, a father to the fatherless, a defender of widows, is God in his holy dwelling. God sets the lonely in families, he leads out the prisoners with singing. Sing to God, you kingdoms of the earth, sing praise to the Lord. To him who rides across the highest heavens, the ancient heavens, who thunders with mighty voice. Proclaim the power of God, whose majesty is over Israel, whose power is in the heavens. You, God, are awesome in your sanctuary. The God of Israel gives power and strength to his people. Praise be to God.
The heavens exalted, name above all other names, Lord over all of creation, worthy of power and praise. Blessing and honor and glory are his eternal reward. Let every knee bow before him, every tongue say he is Lord. Jesus, you are exalted and glorified. Jesus, name above all names, will lift you high. Came as nothing, choosing the road to the cross. Lord, you were found in our likeness, shedding your glory to serve. Humble, not claiming advantage, you laid down your life for the world. Jesus, you are exalted and glorious. Above all names, we'll lift you high. Oh, 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 oh. Let us be found in your likeness, learning to serve as you. Filled with your spirit, your fullness, the fragrance of grace on the earth. You love the heart that is humble, you desire worship that's true. Voices that sing for your glory, and lives that bring honor to you. Jesus, you are exalted and glorified. Jesus, name above all names, will lift you high. Savior, all of creation will bow in awe. Jesus, from every nation we'll call you.
Jesus, you are exalted and glorified. Hello and welcome to our service today for Newcastle West Methodist Circuit and all of our many friends watching this too. It's great that you've joined us, and I hope that you enjoyed that cracking new song by Judy Gresham that I absolutely love. And we do indeed lift high the name of Jesus as we share together and worship him today. And I want to thank in advance members and friends at Denton Burn Methodist Church who've helped out with this service today. One of those people is dear John Willis from Denton Burn, who celebrated his 80th birthday on Monday just gone. John was the person who designed the fantastic millennium windows at Denton Burn that are always very much admired at the front of the church. And it was lovely that he received so many well wishes and cards and cakes and treats for people on his special day on Monday. Here he is with one of the numerous things that were baked and dropped off for him on Monday. By all accounts, he had a wonderful day, despite being somewhat restricted. And John will be leading the Lord's Prayer for us later on. When I watched that first song back after recording it, I realised that people might be wondering why I seem to have something that looks a little bit like a grey gerbil on my shirt while I was singing. So in case you're wondering, it's not actually a gerbil. It's a fluffy windshield that we've bought for when we're outside recording and it's a bit windy, to protect us from the rumble of the wind. We could call him Jerry the Gerbil, I suppose, but just in case you were wondering what it was, it's a windshield, and I'm sure you'll be seeing very much more of him in the future, sitting on people's shirts and tops. If I was to ask you how many Easter eggs you still had in your house by now, I suspect it would likely you'd give the same answer as our house, precisely none. Of course, by now, Easter Sunday and that celebration of Jesus' resurrection can seem a long time ago by now, this last official Sunday in the Easter season. But I received a lovely little present the other day, made by Crystal, a girl who's a regular at Leamington Messy Church. And she really wanted to make this and have it passed on to me. I'll let Crystal tell you in her own words all about it.
Hi, I'm Crystal. I've made this for the Methodist Church from school because I was doing weaving, and for a different choice I thought of Jesus. So what I did was I made this for the Methodist Church. So I made Jesus in the cave when the two people went and looked for Jesus and he was gone because he was alive. And then I've made the tree, what was next to it, and the sun and the cloud. And then at the same time, when Jesus walked out, all the flowers started springing around him.
Isn't that lovely? And for me, it's a timely reminder that we live our lives in the light of Jesus' resurrection every day of our lives, long after our Easter eggs have all gone. Many of you will remember when it was the London Olympics back in 2012, when an Olympic torch relay went round on a route all over the UK carrying the Olympic flame. At the time, they tried to make sure that the torch route was at less than an hour's travelling time for 95% of the UK population, so as many people as possible could witness the flame being carried. About 8,000 torches were used in all, and the relay lasted 70 days with 66 evening celebrations. About 8,000 people carried the torch, a total distance of about 8,000 miles. And the campaign for the torchbearers was called Moment to Shine. Thursday this week was what we traditionally call Ascension Day, a time when we remember Jesus going back to be with the Father, when he handed the baton, or the torch you might say, over to his followers, saying essentially, carry the good news about the kingdom of God to the ends of the earth. But he didn't leave us with just an empty torch to carry with some words tucked in the top. As we'll be hearing in our Bible reading shortly, Jesus told his followers to wait, to essentially wait for the flame, that flame being the Holy Spirit. I wonder, Maybe it's our moment to shine, as Jesus calls us all in different ways to carry the flame of his love out to everyone. Let's pray together now. Let's pray. Some words from Psalm 148. Praise the Lord from the heavens, praise him from the skies, praise him all his angels, praise him all the armies of heaven, praise him sun and moon, praise him all you twinkling stars, praise him skies above, praise him vapours high above the clouds, let every created thing give praise to the Lord, for he issued his command and they came into being. He set them in place for ever and ever. His decree will never be revoked. Father, we do indeed thank you and praise you that by the power of your command this entire universe was spoken into being and is subject to your sovereign reign and rule, and that you are ever faithful to us and your promises to us will never be revoked. Heavenly Father, we thank you that whoever we are and wherever we are, we can share in this time together. Lord, we might be scattered about in our various homes, but we still join together, united in you, and knowing that you are present with us and that you continue to surround us with your love. Lord, although we share in this time from different places, you still know each of our hearts. You know the burdens as well as the joys that we're carrying at the moment. And you also know the times when we've lived in ways that are not honouring to you. And so, Father, we want to say sorry for the times when we've fallen short of how you would have us be, when we haven't lived how Jesus would call us to live. Times when our hearts have harboured thoughts and inclinations that you would not have wanted there. And so with our hearts laid open, we want to say sorry. And we ask, Lord, for all these things to be washed away through your glorious grace and love for us. We thank you that you actively seek relationship with us, running towards us with open, non-socially distanced arms as we run towards you and seek your face too. Lord, we praise you this morning together. And in your precious name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. We're going to sing again now. Lord, I lift your name on high. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the skies. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. So glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
This reading is from Acts 1, verses 1 through 11. The promise of the Holy Spirit. In the third book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem, in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of sight. While he was going, they were gazing upon heaven. Suddenly, two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus who has been taken up into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him going to heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty. All the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great we
They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand here staring into the sky? I've no idea how long those first followers of Jesus have been standing there staring into the sky, but it would seem it was long enough for some seemingly angelic beings of some kind to appear alongside them to comment on it. But you've got to have some sympathy for them, haven't you? I mean, think about it. It's not been that long since they lost Jesus to the cross and to the tomb. They thought that all was lost then. But then they wrestled with the crazy turn of events that started to unfold 3 days later, that despite the best efforts of the Romans and their guards at the tomb, Jesus was not dead and buried and gone. He was very much alive. And this was something that they bore witness to for the rest of their lives. And in many cases, it cost them their lives, carrying that conviction that Jesus had risen from the dead. So they'd come to terms with the fact that he hadn't gone. They'd got him back. All was well. Except that now they're apparently watching him leave again, in events every bit as strange and supernatural as what had happened at the tomb. And as in some way or other, he rises away from them, becomes obscured by a cloud and vanishes. And they're left staring into the sky. Perhaps they were hoping that he was going to pop his head back round the side of that cloud and say, "I had you going there, of course I'll stay with you." But no. So I'm not surprised they were left staring. After all that had gone on, I'm sure I wouldn't have been any different. Jesus, who had promised them and us, "I am with you always, right to the close of the age," was, at least in one sense, leaving. He wasn't going to be with them in the same way that he had been, at least. But as tempting as continuing to stare into the sky must have been, this really wasn't the end again. This actually marked the start of a whole new beginning. This story comes from the very first part of the book of Acts, which was written by Luke, who, after writing the Gospel or Good News of Luke, which was all about Jesus, was on such a roll that he went on to write the book of Acts, which begins with Jesus in the first bit, but then is about Jesus handing the baton over to his followers, essentially saying to them, "Wait and see what I'm going to bring to birth through you." And this had always been the plan. Before this, we read that on an earlier occasion, while he was eating with them, Jesus gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem." So the story starts in Jerusalem. "Don't leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days' time, you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." And so they asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to return the kingdom to Israel?" Remember that they were under an oppressive Roman occupation at the time. But Jesus says to them, "It's not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. Speculation about the restoration of Israel isn't what's important right now. What's important now, as I'm about to ascend back to the Father, is that you wait in Jerusalem, because you, my flawed but loved ragtag of followers and nobodies, are about to be transformed, because you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses." So this is what is compelling to Jesus in this passage. You're going to receive the Spirit. The very indwelling presence of the divine will come to reside in each of you. "So I am leaving," Jesus essentially says, "but I'm leaving for a very good reason. I am leaving so that my presence, the very Spirit of God, can reside within every one of you. And you will change the world forever." And he says, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and then in all of Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Because this story is not going to stay here just in Jerusalem. It's going to grow. And what you're going to do, my followers, because the very divine presence is within you, is you are going to go. And then he lists the next nearest regions, Judea and Samaria. Now, I'm no scholar of the original Greek language here. I skipped that module at college. But I'm told that in the Greek at this point, it's not saying in Judea and then in Samaria. It's Judea and Samaria. Now, why is this a big deal? Well, because Judea and Samaria are pretty much arch enemies. If you're in Judea and you wanted to go to the country on the other side of Samaria, you didn't generally walk straight through Samaria. You went many miles out of your way, so you wouldn't have to set foot on Samaritan soil. You despise the Samaritans. These two groups were at each other's throats. This is ethnic division, if there ever was any. And it's to this group, to these people, who can't stand each other, Jesus says, you're going to go to them and them. And he lumps them in together. What? We're going to go to Samaria and we're going to go to Judea. We're going to St. James's Park and to the Stadium of Light. We're going to go to Israel and Palestine. No. Here's how the world works. You go to one or you go to the other. You're on the one side or you're on the other. Nobody goes to both. Think of the most divisive, at each other's throats sort of groupings we have in society. Ideologies, devotions, allegiances. And here's what's going to happen. The very presence of God is going to empower you. The Greek word for power here is the word dunamis, which means dynamite. The very dynamite of God will be so present within you that this message of the open tomb, this message of the kingdom of God, this message of the joy and peace of the Creator being yours through this Christ, you're going to find yourself breaking down all sorts of boundaries and divisions. This empowering divine presence is going to free you to take this message beyond Jerusalem, beyond any ethnic, cultural allegiances or boundaries you can possibly comprehend. You're going to find yourself at the ends of the earth with this message. Because this message can't stay in Jerusalem. It can't just be kept in a particular cultural box in Jerusalem. Its very nature is to reach more and more people. It needs to reach more and more people. And no cultural or ethnic or I really don't like them boundaries are going to get in the way. It's going to go and it's going to go and it's going to go. And you, my good people, my humble, flawed, crazy sort of disciples, you are the ones through whom this message needs to go, and it's going to go right to the ends of the earth. It's interesting that much further on in chapter 8 of the book of Acts, it says that a persecution broke out because the disciples were still in Jerusalem. So Jesus says in chapter 1, you're going to need to leave Jerusalem and take the message to more places. And 8 chapters later, they're still there. And it's only when a persecution breaks out that it starts to move onwards. Now, this passage is probably about a number of different things. But one key thing you can say is this. There is identity, who you are. And the New Testament writers often speak about who you are and who we are in Christ. They speak of a new identity. You are not fundamentally defined by your sins any longer. You can be wholly sanctified. You can be a new creation because of Jesus. And for anyone who would look at their current lives and circumstances and say, I know I need more than this. I know I've messed up and I need to start again. I promise you that whoever you are watching this today, Jesus knocks at the door of your heart and says, let me in. I will recreate you. I will change you. You can have a fresh start in me. So you don't find people in the New Testament so much talking or calling themselves sinners. The word is saints. Your fundamental identity can change because of Jesus. You may still sin. You may still really mess up from time to time, but that is no longer your fundamental identity. You have a new identity, and you are learning and growing and being pulled into your new identity. Your past does not define you. Your life in Christ is the phrase that is used in the Bible. And if proof were needed that this was happening even back with Jesus' first followers, just look at Peter, the one who denies Jesus and lies and says, "No, I don't even know him." And we know that he disowned Jesus at least 3 times. And yet later on, we find Jesus telling Peter that he is to lead his people. Jesus describes Peter as being the rock on which he will build his church. And there are so many stories told of people who really fall flat on their face, and yet Jesus still says, "I can use them." And he can use us. Because in him we find a new identity. Whatever our past is, doesn't have to define us anymore. We have changed identity. And maybe you need to hear this today. And this passage touches on that, but it's also about something else. Because what you also find in the New Testament again and again is a new sense of belonging. You are a new creation. You have been redeemed, renewed, and power washed. But it isn't just your identity transformed. You now belong to a new family. We heard the psalmist declare earlier in Psalm 68 that God puts the lonely in families, into families. You now have new brothers and sisters. You are part of a tribe, a group, a church. And so you find lots of passages and writings about the one another's. Care for one another. Mourn with one another. Rejoice with one another. Forgive one another. Bear each other's burdens. So it isn't just about you and what's happened in you. You are now part of a whole new community. And whilst it's true that as individuals can be and are being transformed by Jesus, another side to it is that we're joined to a whole community that is being transformed together. And that's very important too. But to be honest, all that is really just the foundation to what this passage is really about. Because this is really a passage about mission. Now you all together, you individuals with new identity joined to others with new identity, together you have a mission in the world. Because if you have identity and belonging without mission, you have a country club, or in our case, a Methodist social club, just like any other social club, except perhaps without any beer, which, let's face it, isn't going to get very far. And if you have mission without identity and belonging, you have a wonderful humanitarian organisation, which is great and very worthy. But that's not what Jesus really had in mind either. What Jesus is really talking about here is people who have been transformed, who have the divine presence residing within them, who are in community with others, and who also understand that we have a mission that goes way beyond us. And so this passage isn't just about Jerusalem, and this passage isn't just about Judea and Samaria. This is about a kind of message for every human being everywhere. The Christ who loves, who dies for, and who is resurrected for every person everywhere. And these flawed, normal, average sort of disciple apostles who are a lot like us, who are handed this and told, "Now here's how it's going down. You go and change the world." I wonder whether at least sometimes we can find ourselves, in a sense, staring into the sky. Come, Lord Jesus, come back. You're somewhere out there, obscured by the clouds. We'll just keep watching and hoping that you'll pop back down and make everything better for everyone. And as Christians, we do believe that one day there will be a return of Jesus. But for now, in this time frame, we need to remember that Jesus handed the baton over to us. The mission continues. It certainly didn't stop or change in any way with Jesus' first disciples. We, his flawed, ordinary folk, who really aren't perfect at all, just forgiven and renewed, we are to continue to be his witnesses out to the ends of the earth. And although after having been with us here on the earth for a time, Jesus did ascend and return into glory with the Father, he really hasn't left. He makes available to us his Holy Spirit, the very essence of God, which can come and reside in every heart that is open to receive. And it will be like dynamite, dunamis, and will empower and equip not just you alone, but empower and equip this whole new family of God that watching this you may be part of. Or for some of you watching this, I want to say, you know that you can be part of this. Because in Jesus there's identity and there's belonging, and then together there's mission. And mission is for anybody who anywhere and at any time has been witness to something of the saving and life-giving grace of Jesus. It isn't just for special people. It isn't just for those with theology degrees, of which I'm not one. Mission is for all sorts of average, totally normal people. And we can witness in many different ways. Some people are very good at witnessing with words. Some people are very articulate and can take ideas and put wonderful words around these ideas in a way that means people say, yes, I get that. And some people love to debate and love to argue a point. But sometimes we can witness with our actions, and sometimes it can simply be with our presence. There are some people in our community who, if they were to meet a Christian who was simply present with them and was not mean or angry or narrow-minded or judgmental, that would be a giant leap forward for them. Sometimes it's about risk, as we're called to witness and to love to whoever represents Samaria for us, those who are poles apart from ourselves, because witness and risk often go hand in hand. Witnessing and serving when empowered by the divine spirit of the Creator living within you usually involves all sorts of risk. But that's what Jesus calls us into together. That's the commission that he leaves us with as he ascends to be with the Father. That's when the events of Easter end, and the work for us as the growing and expanding church that can't stay still begins. Let's pray together. For those today who need to hear good news about identity, those who perhaps have been dragging their past around everywhere, maybe struggling with temptations, addictions, destructive ways of living, and maybe it owns and dominates you, and you have a somewhat crushed sense of who you are. For you, the gospel announcement is that in Christ you are a new creation, and you are not that, you are somebody new. And the prayer for you is, Lord, help me to know more clearly who I am in you, a new creation. Lord, bless me with your new life and my new identity in you. We pray for those of us who feel a bit beaten down or maybe exhausted or with heads full of negative messages about who you are, Lord. People who are convinced that they're going to mess up again in the future. Those who need to allow themselves to be carried by others. May they know and experience your promise of belonging, which is part of the kingdom we proclaim. We pray, Lord, that you would help us all to know how to let the faith of others carry us when we can't carry ourselves. Help us to remember that we belong to a family that supports and carries, even when we're weighed down with doubts or struggles. Lord, help all of us to remember that we belong to your special family, despite our current isolated and spread out circumstances. We also pray for anyone struggling with Judea or Samaria kinds of places in their lives, those being called into foreign or strange environments, those thinking, I don't know what I would do if I were there. And yet something within you keeps saying, I'm supposed to be in that place. I'm supposed to be light in that darkness. And so although you're very apprehensive, your prayer today would be, here I am, Lord, send me. Lord God, as we reflect on the birth of the church, this witnessing community of people who found new identity and new life, we ask that you would invigorate us for mission. For some of us, it will be as simple as seeing particular relationships in a whole new way. For some of us, it will be involvement in something. It will be some sort of risk. There's some sort of need, and it's ours to meet. We pray, Lord, that wherever we are in this moment, that you would breathe into us all new wind, new life, new energy, a new sense that we are here, that our life matters, that there is purpose and meaning, that together we can do something and be something and do something in the world, so that others may experience your love as we have. In the strong name of the resurrected Christ, everybody said, Amen.
Here are our prayers of intercession. There will be a bidding and a response which will be shown on the screen. Let us pray. Blessed are you, Lord our God, for you have raised your Son from the darkness of death to the fullness of life eternal. By his ascension he has opened for us the gate of glory. Blessed are you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Lord our God, as we rejoice in the Ascension, we give thanks for men and women of vision and those who have shared their faith with us. We remember all who feel life is dull and all whose lives are clouded by doubt or despair during this period of uncertainty and danger from the coronavirus pandemic. We pray your blessing on all those who are struggling with their faith. May they be uplifted by our weekly services, proclaiming the good news of your saving acts during the lockdown. And we bless all those who bring these services to us in all their different ways. May we all come to know the joy of the presence of the ascended Lord. Lord, with us always, hear us and help us. Lord, as we rejoice in your presence, we remember and pray your blessing on all those who feel lonely and neglected in our world, those who are oppressed and those struggling to survive, and those whose lives are plagued by poverty and famine. We remember and pray your blessing on all who live in bad housing, in deprivation or squalor, and we pray also for the homeless. We remember and pray your blessing on all those caught up in violence and war, the forgotten refugees whose camps are a breeding ground for contagion. We remember and ask your blessing too on those who are still working through the consequences of natural disasters. Lord, with us always, hear us and help us. Lord, as we rejoice in your love, we pray that you will be with and bless those who lead nations, our own government, and those who advise them. We pray your blessing for all scientists working so hard to find treatments and vaccines to protect us from the virus and successfully treat those infected by it. We remember and ask your blessing on our loved ones who we are unable to meet or hug until this problem is behind us. We pray also for our communities and our neighbours on whom many of us have come to rely. We ask your blessing upon all who strive to brighten the world by their dedication and goodness, those providing community support. We pray your blessing for their continued faith and willingness to sacrifice. Lord, with us always, hear us and help us. Lord, as we rejoice in your power, we remember and pray your blessing on all those whose powers are waning, the elderly and the infirm, those living a lonely existence. We pray your blessing also on all our congregations, especially those for whom special prayers have been requested. We pray your blessing on all who have suffered or are suffering from COVID-19, and for all the health and social care staff whose dedication is unwavering. May they all find courage in you and in your abiding love. Lord, with us always, hear us and help us. Lord, we rejoice that you are our brother, redeemer and friend, who ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God to make intercession for us. We pray your blessing on all loved ones and friends departed from us, and pray that they know your joy and peace. We commend them, this world, and ourselves to your unfailing love. Lord, with us always, hear us and help us. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We'll now say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
And use every
so may you know God's peace, presence and power living and working within you. May you know that in Christ you are a new creation. You are adopted into the family of the kingdom. And may you spread the good news of Jesus in his power to your Judeas and Samarias and even unto the ends of the earth. Amen.